Okay, hey everybody, welcome to the first and maybe only episode ever, I don't know. I guess it's a macro photography live show here on Bubbleman's World, sort of specializing on the MPE lens, this lens right next to me actually, put out by Canon. I picked it up in 2008 and have never looked back. Let me get the link sent out to the few people that I've managed to invite in today for this episode. I think you guys will be looking forward to this as much as I am. I think it's going to be good fun, you know. I've been shooting cannabis for probably 25 years, literally. The minute you start growing it, the first thing you want to do is get a camera and be able to take pictures of it. Of course, back in the early days, for me anyway, it was dangerous to get the film, to take the film into a store and have it turned into photographs. This was something that you had to be very careful with, particularly if you didn't want to have the police knocking on your door. So it's kind of come a long, long way, especially considering cannabis was always one of those things for that very reason that maybe you shouldn't be photographing or keeping evidence or having pictures of yourself in with the cannabis, but people love their cannabis, and even when it was as illegal as possible, you'd still see people taking photographs of themselves with cannabis, taking pictures of cannabis, taking pictures of the hash, etc., etc., etc. Good evening, Tatman Adderman, Spokane Cannabis Review, holding down the chat right now, Dabzilla, and I think Icana. Hello and welcome to the show. I'm glad we've got some people watching. It looks like we've got about 53 people watching right now. And I was actually thinking of maybe sending out the link real quick on Facebook and letting everyone know that we are live. They feel like coming on. Put that out there. Booyah. And yeah, so I've invited a bunch of different folks into the room today. I'm not sure who's going to make it. Who knows? Maybe it'll just be me talking about macro photography for the next little while. I do have my camera here, and I've managed to tether it, set it up to my computer, which is something I've actually done maybe a handful of times, two or three times. It's not really my preferred way of shooting. I was having a conversation earlier in regards to how I learned to do handheld was even to get it, let alone off of wires, but even off of tripods. And we'll talk a little bit about that later on in regards to, you know, why you'd want to learn handheld with macro. It's much easier to get it on a nice tripod or a rail system and even start stacking and using multiple images to get these clear images. But I think there's something to be said for the learning aspect of shooting macro. And being able to hold it and being able to track your subject. I learned with bugs, for instance. Bugs were incredible, very small, little tiny, almost invisible bugs that I would find out on like telephone poles in the morning dew. I would put my macro lens there and you'd see them come up. Hey, welcome.
What's up?
Kale?
I'm going to turn the music off. There we go.
Yeah, you got it coming in a little bit loud, but it's good. We can hear you. It's nice. Welcome, both of you.
Sweet. Yeah, Daisy's over here. Hi.
Welcome, welcome to the MPE 65 millimeter macro photography live show on Bubbleman's World. Absolutely not repeating that. The only thing I would suggest is when more people show up, because you guys have a loud mic, just mute yourselves when you're not talking. It sounds perfect right now, but just once a few more people show up. I just sort of started kind of talking a little bit about macro photography and a little bit about cannabis photography and how people have always been inclined to photograph their cannabis, even back when it was quite illegal. And it's nice to see how far it's come along with the specialized lens like the MPE, which we'll get into in a little bit. Is that the lens that you shoot with as well, Kale?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, well, you got great shots. You're on Instagram under what name?
Shwale, S-H-W-A-L-E.
Shwale, exactly, right. I gotcha. So, yeah, go give Shwale a follow on Instagram. He's definitely got some super quality images. I was happy that he was able to come in and discuss. I see you got your rig right behind you there.
Yeah.
Excellent. And you got the rail system?
I do. Yeah, I just have some cheap rail. I couldn't tell you the name.
I've never actually used a rail like for my photography. People are always kind of blown away when I tell them that. And I think it's great to have a rail and learn it, but I always tell new photographers that if you can, and I was talking about this actually right before you came in, because I learned with bugs. I learned from the macro community, and a lot of the macro community, they shoot flowers and they shoot bugs and different plants and other sort of things. But yeah, bugs I found really helpful because obviously they don't stop moving. They like to move. And so you end up having to actually track your subject a little bit, which helped me later on when I was shooting in rooms like Remo, the urban grower, who's got this incredible system set up where all the plants are just shaking basically because his airflow is so incredible. The only downfall is when I go in to shoot the plants, because they're so big, I can't just take them out of the room, and I can't turn off his airflow. So I'm actually, you know, when I'm shooting Remo's plants, I'm kind of like a pendulum. I'm just sitting there with my lens, kind of trying to get into the sequence of motion of the bud. Because sometimes it's easy back and forth, left and right, but often it's a little more complex where it's going back but down at a bit of an angle and then coming forward and to the left at a higher angle. And you start learning when you don't have the rail and you don't have the use of the tripod how to sort of track and get that shot right at that moment. I've been blown away at some of the shots I've managed to get handheld. And of course, watching these macro shooters on these different Canon communities, well, they're shooting bugs that are flying in the air. Have you seen these?
No, I haven't actually.
I'm telling you, you know, I don't know if you've shot many bugs with your lens, but it's an amazing world to get into if not.
Yeah, it's definitely super difficult. I always have a hard time with like any moving subject really.
Yeah, that's training. I did that. I must have done that for a couple of hours every morning for like 2 years. You know, just go out and find the bugs and, you know, get the lens out. I kind of wanted to actually start with a couple of how we got into macro photography. Did you want to start the, because I've been yammering on for a while and we got.
Eric was actually saying the link's not working. So I'm getting texts from him. So I was trying to get him in here.
Is he coming in on a phone perhaps?
I'm not sure. I'll ask.
Send it to him again. There are some times needing to be a little bit of technical difficulties. But in the meantime, for the 130 people that are watching, I will tell how I got into macro photography. For me, it was very much Youp Dumas, who first inspired me in the early 90s when I went to the Cannabis Cup in Amsterdam. And Youp was taking photographs, I believe, even in the 80s or the mid or late 80s, if not the very early 90s, of with an electron scan microscope. And I'm not sure if he was at the university doing this. I would have loved to have gotten him in here. Not that he speaks English, but we could have had him speak Dutch and had someone translate. Anyway, if you went to the Cannabis Cup back in the day and you saw those postcards and you saw you know, he would have a booth from 94 on throughout the 90s. He always had a booth at the Cannabis Cup of his impeccable macro photographs of single glandular trichomes and such. It was one of my first advertisements for bubble bags in 1999 when I advertised in Cannabis Culture and Red Eye and High Times. I used a photograph of his that I paid almost 1,000 guilders for back then to own the image. I recognized the quality of his photography, and I saw no one else really doing it. And I bought that image, and I did the ad in the magazine, which was actually a picture of that trichome. And then it had a bunch of mountain climbers kind of climbing up using picks and stuff. And then there was a dude on top that was supposed to be me chopping away at the head and filling little bags, bubble bags, and sending them down this little kind of line that was set up. And that was the original ad, if anyone ever saw that. That, you know, a couple of years went by, and eventually I saw Jason King started getting into macro photography for his Canon Bible. He wanted to get in closer and show macro photographs. He was kind of one of the first ones to really, you know, have the book of buds, but then come out with close-up versions of the buds, and I really thought that was cool. The only thing I unfortunately didn't find cool is when I asked Jason, hey, I have an interest in getting into macro photography. Can you help me out? You know, come equipment I need to buy. And he basically told me that he would tell me what equipment to buy when I showed him how to manufacture bubble bags and sell them worldwide on the internet. And I was kind of in shock, actually, at the time. Yeah, there's Jason, one of Jason's books right there.
Yeah, definitely what got me into it right here. Right.
So imagine when I – oh, welcome, Eric. What, Rye, sorry.
Right.
Welcome, dude. Can you hear us?
Yeah, what's up?
Excellent. Right on, dude. I'm just telling my hilarious story about asking Jason King to help me get into macro photography, and he gave me a resounding no in only a sarcastic manner that Jason could give. So I was kind of like, okay, no worries. I'll move on. And it was actually a guy by the name of Monkey who was on IC Mag and Overgrow. He was taking pictures of praying mantises, and his photography was epic, as well as perhaps your giddy aunt, who was the first to really photograph the classic clear dome photo that he did on Overgrow way, 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 way back. This isn't his, this is one of mine, but this was very much inspired by perhaps your giddy aunt from back in 02 or 01 even, using the MPE lens as well. And, you know, it was Monkey who told me the lens, you know, told me what camera to get, which for those of you wondering about the MPE, it is a specialized lens for Canon. You would get pretty much any Canon body. I'm not sure if there's any of the DSLRs fit this lens. I'm pretty certain. Isn't that correct, guys?
Think so.
Yeah, I mean, I started with a 40D. The photos I took was with a 40D, and I eventually moved into a 5D Mark II, and now I shoot with a 5D Mark III. And I absolutely love the lens, and it's what we're here to talk about. So I want to welcome Rye Pritchard into the room, who just showed up a little bit ago. Thanks for coming in, dude.
Hey, Rye.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, we're going to have a good little conversation. We got 120 people watching right now, kind of wanting to learn a little bit about macro photography. It's hard because we didn't really plan it. It was just kind of like, let's get a bunch of people to shoot with the lens. You know, if you don't shoot Canon, it's not the end of the world. There are some impeccable macro photographers that use lens reversal kits. You can buy, you know, 50 and 60 millimeter lenses and then buy simple little reversal kits that allow your Nikon or whatever you're shooting with to reverse those lenses. And then in between that, you can get into billows and extension tubes. Which I'm pretty sure Beer Goggles from Instagram is, he's one of the premier reverse lens macro shooters that I know of in the cannabis industry anyway. He takes absolutely stunning photographs using that setup. But for those of you in the Canon world, I definitely would promote you to at least go rent the MPE if you have the ability from a camera shop. A lot of them in most cities carry the MPE lens, and it's pretty reasonable to rent. I rented it half a dozen times before I bought it, in fact, just playing around and getting used to it. And I've actually got it set up to my computer today, so when we get into maybe talking about the subtle nuances of the lens, I thought I could share my screen a little bit, and we could look at some of the quality. We could see the image and how much it shakes. You know, I'm sure you guys are used to seeing the shake on your live view. And, you know, what do you guys, for instance, how did you go about, you know, deciphering or learning to manipulate that shake to get that sweet spot shot?
Well, I definitely try to isolate as much as I can. Try to stay like on concrete. You know, I use.
Nope, we got you. You try to put it on concrete. I definitely was there with you for a while. I remember, you know, how much a bag of sand, even hanging from the center of my tripod, helped. You know, as well as not buying the lightest tripod, which sucks when you're carrying gear. But it's definitely useful when you're taking macro shots. What shale means by putting it on concrete, many of you might not understand or notice this, but when you're standing in front of the lens, if you're on a wood floor, for instance, and you shift your weight, even at 120 to 40 pounds, you're definitely going to shift the weight just enough to move the tripod a fraction of a millimeter, which is huge when it comes to the depth of field that we're shooting at, especially when the lens is not so much like this at 1-1, But once you get it to 2-1 and 3-1 and up to 4-1 and then finally 5-1, you get this incredibly shallow depth of field that only people who shoot with the MPE can possibly really learn to understand. It's as though your monitor were having a seizure, like a very bad seizure. That's how much the live view screen moves for some of us in certain situations. Hey, Eric's incredibly shallow.
Hey, guys.
Nugshots in the house. Hey, nice display of photography. You're making me... I've got my shit printed out on a swaggy like paper printer. Buddy comes in with
a borrowed office.
I'm just gonna shame Bubbleman. Actually, you know what? I do have this though.
Wow. Nice.
I got my pillow I'm sitting on. Welcome, Nugshots, to the room. It's an honor to have you here in the MPE room. Sorry for such kind of an invitation. I've been trying to put this together for a little bit, and Spokane Cannabis Review says he's got your book.
Thank you.
Wicked. How long you been shooting with the MPE?
MPE is actually more recent for me. I'd say probably a year or two is my experience with it.
Nice. And then before you were shooting with 50s, 60s, and 100s, or?
Yeah, and extension tubes. Kind of tried a little bit of everything.
Mm-hmm. And so did you go the standard route like most of us I know did? Did you get into, you know, macro photography forums and start doing all the little macro tricks like trying to get refractions and water droplets? And
oh, yeah. I mean, I've been doing photography since I was a little kid and always trying to, you know, experiment with, like, whatever new kind of thing, like panoramas or HDR. But I'm pretty much self-taught, so yeah, going on the forums and looking at what other people have done, that's definitely how I got to where I'm at.
Awesome, dude. Well, good on you, man. It's beautiful shots for certain.
Thank you.
It's nice to see more people. Like when I first got into the macro cannabis thing, it almost seemed like there was just so few people doing it, and I really felt like Jason King for me was one of the first, not the first, because Youp Dumas had him by 15 years or so, and the pictures, if you look at Youp, which is spelled J-O-O-P-D-U-M-A-S, he's a Dutchman, he just took the most stunning photographs, obviously using a multi-hundred-thousand-dollar electron scan microscope. Which was, you know, a little bit cheating, but it got really inspired me, and it was that led me to you know, ask Jason about whether he could point me in the right direction. And when he was unable to point me in the right direction, it was Monkey, who literally was so helpful from Overgrow and IC Mag. I'm not sure if you guys remember this character, but beautiful photographs of praying mantises that he ordered and would have in his home. And he really was so helpful. He, you know, not only gave me the website with the number of the lens I needed to get, with the specialized flash that I would require, with bodies that could be used with it, and tripod heads. He then, you know, spent his time giving me settings to start at, f-stops and white balances and the whole nine yards, which for me was, you know, it was a form of radical openness that I just immediately enjoyed. It's the whole purpose of Hash Church is for us to share our ideas so that someone can, yes, brace yourself, take the idea and do more with it than you were going to do. Oh my goodness. I know it sounds terrible. Your idea was taken by someone else. But this is what it's all about, sharing our concepts and our, you know, sharing the mistakes that we had to make to get to where we are, so maybe other people don't have to make the same mistakes. They can make a whole new set of new ones, and as they say, standing on the shoulders of giants. I always feel like I've been lucky enough to stand on the shoulders of giants, and I will forever give credit to those who helped and pointed me in the right direction, and it's thanks to them that I have always shared any amount of information that I could in regards to photography. I just never really understood where I would have to come from to want to keep someone from knowing that, hey, if you lower the f-stop substantially on the MPE anyway, you can get these incredibly crisp shots in a smaller depth of field, but so crisp that you'll just never get the same shot shooting at a wider angle at a higher f-stop. And
definitely.
Telling people that is helpful. You know, it might seem it's easy to learn on a website, but it's okay for us to also share this information with one another. Really, the whole purpose today to get you guys here was to share some of your experiences, talk a little bit about your photography with the macro lens and with cannabis as your subject, and to just really inspire the next generation of people who want to do what we are currently doing, which is taking really, really high quality macro shots of cannabis and other subjects. So yeah, checking out the room, it's pretty full. We still got 120 people peeping in. Science is progression. It's good.
So how's it going, Ryan? Eric, you guys good?
Very good.
Going very well.
Met with these guys. Ryan, I know you from Denver. And I remember when I was talking to Ryan, being like, hey, what lens are you using? And it was like not even the MPE back then. So.
I mean, I don't shoot an MPE still. I'm still an Nikon guy right now. So.
Yeah. Nice.
Are you using lens reversals and stuff, Ryan?
I'm not. I'm shooting 1-1 on pretty much everything. I mean, I'll use extension tubes occasionally, but as a rule, I generally don't.
Okay, so let's talk about that. 1-1, what Rye just mentioned, 1-1, is what we call true macro. And now, first of all, I'm not a macro expert at all, so if I say something that sounds stupid, just realize, and I'm not trying to sound like an expert, just been shooting for a while, and I've done my research, but I can make mistakes. I'm just giving you information to go forward with and do your own research. But 1-1 generally is known as true macro. So if you're shooting with a 35 millimeter, which is the plate inside the camera, and you take a picture of a bug that is, say, 15 millimeters long, that bug will be 15 millimeters long on the 35 millimeter image. And so the MPE, it starts where most macro lenses end. It starts at 1-1, meaning you can't shoot anything further. You can't get a portrait. You could maybe get most of someone's eye with this particular lens. It's got a very small front of the lens that's exposed, and 1-1 is where it starts. It moves to 2-1, 3-1, 4-1, and finalizes at 5-1, the way this lens is right now. And then, of course, at 5-1, you can take an image a little closer than this, and you can actually crop, and then at that point, I have no real way of knowing how close I am using the MPE. So I just wanted to sort of let that be heard because, you know, you mentioned 1-1. Yeah, tell us a little bit about shooting 1-1.
Well, I mean, my focus primarily is being able to work in grow rooms and being able to shoot functionally. I have a lot less access to, you know, plants that I can actually even shoot in a studio just because of the way most Colorado grows are set up and the way, you know, I'm just working in tight rooms. It's just really hard. So I generally am shooting freehand. I'm generally hanging off of ladders. I'm generally, you know, then that's part of the reason why I do shoot 1-1. If I was, you know, dangling your rig around at 5-1, I could take a lot of shots and get something useful, but it's really, really difficult to work with that level of magnification in actual working conditions. Where, you know, I mean, the biggest problem in Colorado generally is that you usually can't move the plants out of the room. Most places have some kind of netting or something, the trellises or whatever, and you just literally can't get them out of the lights even. So I'm usually shooting under HPS. So good times.
Oh, I know it well. We were talking about it earlier. A gentleman in the chat room by the name of Spokane Cannabis Review was talking about rails. And my friends have been telling me for years, oh, you need to get a system and should do the combined shots. And I'm like, you know, I don't want to limit myself. I think learning tripod shooting and rails and all these different methods that are available to us as macro photographers are amazing. They're all prosthetics in their own right that will allow you to get a shot that you would otherwise maybe not be able to get. However, with that said, I would learn as much as I could using my hands before I moved forward into getting myself so trapped on a tripod with a giant reversal or whatever kit that you've got. I shoot a lot of my stuff handheld, and people can't believe it. I shoot at 5-1 in grow rooms where plants are going like this, and they won't turn off the fans. And yep. You're right. It is fucking hard. It's insane almost. Like, I can But don't let that discourage you. I would still suggest that you spend a little bit of time practicing doing the handheld thing. There are weird little ways. You know, for instance, when I'm shooting handheld with this particular guy, one of the little tricks that I do, it's a very simple trick, and it's probably pretty much common sense, but I'll use my hand on the front of the lens as my tripod, and I can go up and down with my finger gently. And I've taken this method to use against walls on poles, like in the most absurd. Now, it is an extremely heavy rig. There is no doubting about it. If you have arthritis or if you have bad wrists or fingers, you are not going to be holding this rig with one hand. And more importantly, for the minute or two that you might need to set up your shot, which becomes just becomes very difficult. And I can see that you wouldn't want to waste too much time, you know, shooting those hundreds of shots only to get those few good ones. But it's why I started shooting with bugs. Before I really shot much macro cannabis, I went into the macro forums and I met like Lord V, who, I don't know if you guys know who Lord V is, but Lord V is like the macro photographer god. You got to search him up on Flickr and stuff. He takes the refraction shots that are like flowers with water driplets, and like there's 1,000 of them, and there's a perfect refraction in every single one of them, it, like bugs, and just he is, and he's amazingly humble. You can literally private message the guy, and he will give you solid, really solid information about macro photography. So he was one of the first that told me, you know, don't try to only shoot non-moving subjects. There are tricks, and it's great to shoot non-moving subjects, but if you can learn to track your subject, it will help you when you're shooting something that's not supposed to be moving, but you're at 5.1 and there's wind and it's moving and you can't tether it down. That's tracking. You have to learn how to do this, these simple motions of whether the plant is moving forward and backwards or at a strange angle. And it's definitely, you know, with the MPE, I still haven't learned, and maybe one of you guys can help me out here, how to get the lamp on the damn flash to stay on for more than like 10 seconds. And I've been shooting like that forever. Literally, 10 seconds this thing, the lamp stays on, then it goes dark, and I'm like, no, I gotta reset it. Reset. It drives me nuts.
I don't use the lamp. Fluorescent light I like to keep like super close. I'll have actually 3 completely surrounding it to get as much like cold light on it as I can.
And I understand that for shooting in like a particular controlled situation, but a lot of my macro photography is done like Rye, on location, in rooms. People aren't really, not really set up. I go and shoot licensed production facilities, and they're like multi. I've been in literally like a $20+ million grow facility shooting macro, and I'm like, damn, you guys didn't leave much room for the photographer.
I always okay. So when I go into big grows. You know, same thing. Yeah, going to big grows here and taking photos. I like to just isolate. I take it away. I don't get it out.
So, I love when I can isolate, but once again, like Ryan Colorado saying, I can't remove the plants, and me shooting at Remo's grow and his plants weigh like 4 kilos, it's like you can't get it out of the bloody, out of the door. His plant is so big, he has to harvest it to get it out of the room.
I've got something that might help you out. On Amazon, there's this like little tiny flashlight. If you search Cree, C-R-E-E, LED, it's like 300 lumens, and it's like under $4. That thing is so bright that even at 5:1, you can still see what you've got going on. It really helps.
And when you shoot with your flash, does your flash mellow out that LED blue-esque light that's hitting off the...
Yeah, so... the flash is such bright power that the flash or the flashlight doesn't even show up at all in the shot. So if I took a picture, obviously shooting manual, if I took a picture without the flash on, it's completely black.
Wow, interesting. Hey, a lot of people want you guys to just give a basic lowdown on who you guys are. If maybe we could start with Eric, go through Rye, and then Kale. Just give your Instagrams, give your name, and your you know what you're about.
Cool. So I, like I said, I've been a photographer for most of my life. Around 2009, I started getting into cannabis, and being a photographer, I wanted to explore that. So started a little website called Nugshots and kind of used that as a place to share my my experiments. And, you know, I became more and more familiar with the industry, and as things were progressing, I saw the opportunity to really take it to the next level. So partnered up and we're all in on Nugshots now. So it's not not a hobby anymore, and we're really trying to take things to the next level. So you can follow us at Nugshots on Instagram, and then nugshots.com is our website.
Beautiful. Thank you very much, Mr. Rye.
Yep.
Tell us where they can find you, Instagrams and whatnot.
I'm at Cannabis Encyclopedia on Instagram. On Twitter, it's Cannabis Encyclopedia.
Beautiful, beautiful. And tell us a little bit about what you've been doing with your photography. Oh, did we freeze him up? We got him froze up. Oh, no, he's back. Welcome back. That was pretty quick. Definitely like the shot he's got right there.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to have a little dab on this cannabis episode. I do kind of want to get some MPE going at one point, show a little bit about what we've been talking about in regards to the shake and the, you know, the whole different world that is macro photography, because it really does bring us into a different world that's quite different from this regular world once you get into that prosthetic, which is your macro lens. Welcome back, Rye. We bumped out on us. Trying to go to the chat every once in a while and see what people are saying. They're asking about Christopher Rex. I'm not sure if Christopher is going to be able to make it in. I did send him the link, and hey, I'm just glad these guys managed to make it in for this first sort of download on macro photography. It's I think it's an important part of the education of you know, not only people that are new into cannabis, but also even people that have been into it for quite some time, to understand that this message, these glandular trichomes that we're photographing, they are indeed the carrier of these medicinal components that much of us have been fighting for and being activists on behalf of for the last, well, 20 plus years for myself. I'm sure you guys have been activists for a while in your own right as well.
So what's up, Ryan? What's up these days? Ryan, what are you up to, man? Unmute.
He's like muted out. Let me unmute. There you go.
I'm back. All right. I'm just at work. I'm at Concentrate Remedies right now. So.
Well, we're glad that you were able to like take a little bit of time off work and share some photographs. You got cut off. Did you want to let us know what's going on with your photography and what you're, you know, like the way Nugshot started out as a website and built into this full-blown, you know, professional. Are you guys must recognize the important educational values of these photographs. I mean, that's, it seems to be where we're all kind of moving forward in regards to our macro photography, is that it's extremely educational for people that don't really know.
I mean, especially with...
Yeah, that's one of the biggest focuses that I've kind of done throughout my career, is trying to kind of fuse the two things. I think, you know, I was in Illinois recently, which is a new medical state, and, you know, most of the people there have no idea what these strains even look like. And so if you have verified genetics and you can get good photos out there early, then that patient population will be able to understand what they should be looking for in certain varieties and that kind of thing early. Whereas, you know, in Colorado, it was just this big crazy shit show for years and years, and we're just finally starting to get it hammered out. So I think, you know, people like ourselves getting into these states early and starting to get some of that information out there, it can be super helpful down the road.
Absolutely. Someone asked, what does it mean to see the trichomes all crippled, like shriveled and missing heads? Generally, that's bud that has been handled, trimmed, cured in bags or jars, and removed, put back in. Yeah, just touched way too much, you know. Look up the hashtag never touched on the Bubbleman brand hash, and you'll get an idea of why we don't touch everything over and over and over again. because untouched is good.
They might be also referring to just like dried nugs as opposed to live nugs.
100%. Although I have dried out nugs.
What, Dane?
Hey, welcome, Dane. A little bit of mic feedback. We've just got to keep our mics muted when we're not talking. And how long have you been shooting with the MPE, Dane? There we go. I just had to mute Rye for a second. It was getting a little bit loud there. I can unmute Dane so we can hear him. What's up?
What's up, everybody? I just got in. Went to Smoking Yards, had some barbecue.
Excellent. Well, we've just been talking about macro photography. A little bit about the MPE and the flash and sort of, I guess we were talking about kind of what got us into this. We're actually, where we're heading with our photography. And I guess, Kale, it was your turn after Rye.
Okay, yeah, I'll go ahead and just make it quick here. I got involved. I started a blog where I was just using a little USB microscope, doing strain reviews. I got contacted by the guys that ran Kind Reviews. And sort of was just given a camera with settings on it and just said, don't touch it. So that was kind of my start. I'm not a professional photographer. I kind of hesitate to call myself that, even though that's how I make a living these days for the most part. So I delved into the macro photography forums like everybody else. But a lot of it was just experience. I was in every grow room in Colorado pretty much between 2010 and 2013, and just got to see a lot of stuff and to figure out how to work in those tough conditions. Because I think that's probably my main skill as a photographer, really, is to work in really tough conditions and to bang out more high-quality shots in a shorter amount of time than, you know, anybody that I've run into. But the studio shots are definitely not my forte, so I think you guys are a little better in that area.
I like the quiver when it comes to my photography. I love having as many abilities as possible. Dane's showing off the gear there. Good fun. I've managed to go on a few trips with Dane around the world, different countries like Holland and Jamaica, and we've always kind of been gearheads and had all of our gear out when Dane and I are like at a table. There, and Tony to boot. Holy shit, is there some serious gear on the table? So what do you got going on? Some lens reversal kits?
I shoot with a Sony system, and I know some of the old school guys who grew up on Canon and Nikon, they don't really like them too much, but I love it. I love the mirrorless setup. So what I have is a adapter for E-mount Sony, and I throw that onto a Sony A7S. And then I'm able to throw the Canon MPE65 onto this mirrorless body, and it really helps out because I don't have the awesome flash like you have, Bubbleman. So what I'm able to do is I'm able to pull focus with high ISO of this camera and kind of see what's going on at a 5x zoom and see exactly what I'm focusing on, and then I bump my ISO way back down and take the shot with the flash. And it's been really effective for me doing macro photography.
That's awesome. Well, I'm glad you're still shooting with your Sonys. You always did like them. I started...
Tony's the one who got the Sony.
He got you into the Sony. Well, my first camera as Bubbleman was a Sony, and it was him, Gypsy, and I went and bought the same one. It was this weird lens, and it was a little digital body, and the lens moved up and down on the digital body. I remember it was 2.1 megapixels, and we paid...
My father got the same one.
Dude, in 1999, I paid $2,000 for that camera. 2.1 megapixels. And that was really the start of bubble bags, showing photographs, digital photographs that were very easy to share online at a time when it was all really happening. You know, people were needing this computer era with the digital camera era, and the online cannabis community were just coalescing in 98, 99, and by 2000 they were fully in bloom. Overgrow was happening. I'm sure most of you were Overgrow members or know about Overgrow from the past. That's where Bubbleman, my name started. Like, that was, I chose that name just to go on the forum, not because I thought, yeah, that'll be the super coolest name ever, but because I had named my product Bubble Bags due to the fact that the hash I made from them melted and bubbled. It was pretty simple, I thought. And then being able to capture those macro photographs of those bubbles was always something that I just absolutely was inspired to do. Let's see what we can get going on here today. Might just do a little screen sharing here and see what I've got here on my camera. I could show just the MPE, Google Hangouts, no, cancel. What do I need to do? I need to open. That's what I need to do. I need to actually open. Is my camera on?
Ah. So Amazon, a generic version of the, I think it's the 24EX, it's the circle ring light that Canon sells for like $250. Yeah. And I was able to pick up a Yongo brand, and it performs to me exactly the same. Now I'm just waiting until they make a ripoff of the $500 one with the two bendy lights. I forget the name of it, the one that you shoot with, Bubbleman.
Right.
Get it.
Sorry, I'm just trying to figure out the camera here. There's no way I killed my battery, is there? I'm going to go get the battery. You guys talk, because I want to do some screen sharing.
Okay.
Never far.
I guess I'll talk about myself. I'm sure Eric knows that we're Schwale on Instagram, S-H-W-A-L-E. Just a name of mine. Kind of been doing the macro thing for a while. Just got into wanting to take a photo of what was going on. I saw some sap in our grow one day and really wanted to get a picture. For those of you that don't know, just like can of honey kind of dripping down the side of the nug, and I just had to get a good shot of it, and that was it. I took some photos for weed maps for a little while, and just always been into photography, and Daisy and I are up here growing now, and got our stuff on the shelf and a garden, so pretty much just taking photos of our own weed.
Awesome, dude. Well, it's good. That's a good way to do it. You know, what better way to get those shots than to take them yourselves? And that's the way I felt. I just felt like I saw Youp Dumas's shot of that single trichome, and I thought, this is amazing. And then everything I saw after that was what I would consider swag, like kind of taken with a microscope. Like just like, okay, like am I supposed to be impressed by this? Because I'm totally not. I need more. And eventually I got turned on to the MPE lens, and it was definitely everything. Sure, I would love to see some new extensions come out for the MPE. Sure, I would like to see them release the lens as a 8-1. But honestly, the 5-1, it's been just an impeccable lens since the day I bought it. It's the same one that I've had the entire time. It's never chipped or broken. It's like a tank. So it's and for those of you that want to pick up the lens, I personally suggest BH Photo. Those guys just have the most ridiculous amount of like camera gear for the cheapest price. I don't know who could really compete with them.
And the best customer service. You cannot deny that.
No, it's true. You're right. Hey, let's do a little screen sharing and look at some of this hash that I have just on my screen right here. I'll go right to remote live view. You guys can let me know if it's working. Let's see if we can get this working. All right. You seeing that?
Yep.
All right, just a couple of different flavors that I got that I have here. The stuff on the left was freeze dried and produced in Ontario by a friend, and the stuff on the right, okay, this stuff, I produced it 8 years ago, which is insane when you think about it. Got to turn on the. There we are. There we go. She is red. CBN rips anyone? So this is trying to keep it as steady as possible on 10. That's no 10 at all. If I went to 10, you would be blown away. Although that's 10. There we go. So yeah, these are little tricks you can do with the camera to get closer. We use this little magnifying glass that will take us in, and then it'll take us in again. So this is the way the shot will look, but if you want to get in and actually see how close
or how clear you've actually got the camera worked out. Because you can see if I lean on the camera a slight bit, it focuses on the back of that ball. And if I push, if I pull back on it, it focuses on the front. Basically taking taking an image. You guys see that? No, it's only showing what was there. I'm still learning this, but kind of neat to see the two different colors, to see the hash that's like a month old next to the hash that's going on its ninth year on this planet. This hash is going to be double digits old soon. And I can tell you, because I photographed it in a multitude of, I cured it in a multiple of ways. Some of the curing just ruined it, and some of the curing just made the tastiest shit ever. Which, and the strangest thing is this stuff right here. This is the cured piece. Let me get my light back on. Take my magnification off. There we go. So this is a cured piece here that's been out on the table. It'll have stuff on it for sure. But this piece here has the most amazing taste of any like cured hash I've ever had. It's very thin. I'm gonna get back to stopping because my camera's just annoying me, but it's the tastiest stuff I've ever had cured for 8 years, and I have four different kinds of this hash cured in four different types of containers, from glass to being preserved in the refrigerator, to some stuff that's actually in a humidor, like a bubble box, and then stuff like this piece that was left out for years, just at room temperature. Definitely hard as a rock. You guys should bring your cameras over and shoot all the random shit on my desk one day. You trip right out. You could make a book for sure.
Have you gotten that stuff tested?
This particular stuff, no, but I have to, because I've never seen such changes in a terpene profile from a cure. And so this stuff here doesn't have a smell, but it tastes like the most intensely cannabis type perfume. Like, it is beyond exotic. It's almost chemical. It's almost like, what the, like, you're confused by it at first, but as it, you know, as you exhale, there's no negative feelings. There's just this really intensely wonderful taste that at first it's so intense it's almost akin to like some fake chemical smell, like a bounce or something, but it is, I assure you, not like a bounce. I wish I could have got more.
So I wanted to ask Eric if he's used these diffusers.
Those, I have actually never used one of those. I use just a standard Canon speed light off camera.
Okay.
Are they Gary's fault?
What was that?
Are those diffusers by Gary Fong?
This is just like some off-brand diffuser for the Macro Twin.
Gary does some pretty pimped out ones. You should look into them. They're just the pattern plastic. They're pretty simple, but
yeah,
lighting is definitely otherworldly. I've never used them on my macro rig, but I do have them for my regular flash when I'm shooting in low light and in dark environments. It's incredible. Absolutely spectacular. So what else we got going on here? Preview. Testing.
I'll go grab my rig real quick. I'll be right back. So I don't have my camera with me. I'll show you guys.
Excellent. I was kind of hoping that Tony was going to be able to make it in, but he's got meetings, so he's unable to make it in. But hey, 140 people have found the link today and are sharing with us as we sit here. I have a ton of hash that I could show on my desk. I kind of put like 10 or 15 different kinds out just to potentially do some photography, but I don't really like the way it's working with my screen sharing and how kind of choppy it is. I'd almost rather take pictures and just share the end results of them. A little bit difficult.
The other thing with using that live view is maybe it's just my camera, but I never get the flash to go off with it. I have to actually turn that off and then take the picture. I don't know. Yeah, maybe that's just a setting I need to look into, but
You should be able to take a picture and still use the flash on live view. I mean, I'm on live view right now. My flash definitely went off.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Isn't it weird that these cameras are so complex? And even when I mentioned it with my with this, which is the lamp. The lamp stays on for like 10 seconds if you're lucky. And I've been shooting like that for like almost 10 years.
I'll get you the link for that flashlight. It just comes in handy for so many different things and so cheap. You might as well get a couple of them even.
I need that in my life.
We got someone in his back of his camera there. All sorts of different rigs people are shooting with. Nikons.
There we go. With old Minolta. I actually have one lens here that's from 87 and the other one's from 1992. An old 100 millimeter and an old 50 millimeter. And this 50 millimeter, or actually this 100 millimeter Minolta has been the sharpest lens I've ever put on my Sony A7S. So good testament to Minolta glass.
Absolutely. I kind of want to shoot something a little nicer. I got these crazy jars given to me recently by a friend, Mitch, in Montreal, that I guess you're supposed to leave them out in the sun and then they're like UV reactive. And so you put your hash or your product in there, you get some sort of something going on. I'll tell you one thing, the hash that I put in here, it greased up nice. I think we got to get it under the macro lens. What do you guys say? Let's get it out of there. Ooh, it's like a greasy little marshmallow. All right, let's see if we can't take a picture or at least show this on the camera lens again. Give me some patience.
What are you shooting with, Rye? I know you have an Nikon set up.
I mean, I honestly shoot with this this Tamron 90. It's done the best for me. I don't see a marked difference with the Nikon glass. I think this is a great workhorse. It's actually a good portrait lens too. I use it for almost literally everything from wide plant shots to macros. I only have another variable lens that I strap on for like wide room shots and events and stuff like that. So, but I definitely use these. These are the Nikon version of those satellite flashes. This is kind of nice. This is the main reason why I shoot Nikon versus Canon, is because I can have 8 of these things all set up around. It's super easy. Not only do they have these nice little convenient stands, which is really convenient for product photography and for like shooting concentrates, but then it has this ring that attaches here, so you can just attach them. What I do a lot of the time is I will attach one here, and then I will hold the other one off camera. To get different depth and different look. It really makes a big difference with plant shots. You can get a lot more depth and a lot, you know, because when you're blasting something with flash, you get a lot of detail, but you lose some of that kind of, you know, what you really want to get out of photography, I think, is kind of the feel of the thing. So I think having the light off camera helps a lot with that. And this is much more usable for me because I can do that with the Canon when you're kind of tethered to the camera. And so it makes it less useful for me.
Yeah. Just getting in on some of this West Coast melt.
That looks fire.
It's definitely fire. Definitely some fire right there. All right, taking distance shots. Just turns off each time, though, the live view. We got to figure out a way to... what camera are you shooting with Nugshots?
It's a 7D.
7D. So if anyone knows how to... It's got to be a live view setting under your live view settings.
I mean, I hardly ever... I use live view for... You know, getting it in kind of where I need to, but then I'll actually go look in through the viewfinder when I'm actually doing the shots. It's I don't like the live view delay where it, you know, clicks the mirror back down and then it does the full cycle for taking the actual picture.
I hear you. I just can't not having my live view. It's so convenient. Be able to get in on the shot that you want and then be like, okay, that's the shape I want. Let's get it clear and then bam.
Live view actually comes in really, really handy for checking your focus, like what you're doing right now. Because in especially with the MPE, it might look like you're focused on the right spot, but then you get it into the computer later and what you were actually shooting is completely out of focus.
I shoot almost constantly off of. See if I can just put that there. If that'll. Oh no, it's not on the desktop. It's still learning how it shares the desktop. It'd be nice if it could just keep it on and we could just see this beautiful, lovely. But I guess it's not always going to work out like that for us, is it? One of the tricks that I have for those of you that are out there shooting macro is that with hash, I just gave this trick to Tony the other day. Not so much the greasy, greasy, greasy stuff, but if you've got some powderized hash, you can really get a much nicer version on your depth of field by sort of pressing down on top of it with like a business card or I use a small little plane of glass that's from a microscope, and I'll just gently press it down. And often, if you've ever seen some of my shots that are all heads, or they're all, you know, those have been done in that format. Otherwise, if you have any ridges in your shot, as you can see here right on this shot, there's a little, it goes in here, so we can go in closer, but eventually the depth of field that we're left with is minimal, and this is, looks like a lot is in focus right now because this is a flat bottom that I'm shooting on right now. The entire piece of this hash was left on a table to become flat, and then I lifted it up and took that picture. So I'll post some of these pictures I'm taking maybe I'll start a macro photography Facebook group. Hard to say what I'm going to do on that one. Usually I just say I'll post the pictures in Hash Church, but we're not in Hash Church right now. We are in macro photography 103, I'll call it. It is bomb, Lonnie Toms, absolute bomb. It's nice to shoot when we're shooting, just like anyone from a photography standpoint. Any photographer can tell you that, you know, whether you're shooting models, whether you're shooting sports, to have someone who's excelling in what they're doing, the subject, if the subject is excelling, then it makes your photography that much easier. And when you're shooting a subject like this, this little piece of hash, which you can see outside of the macro lens, does not look anywhere near as impressive as it does on the macro lens. When you're shooting with absolute fire, it just makes it easier to shine. It's like as a photographer, your real job is to just unveil the quality and let it be seen in the most in the most beautiful way, in the most beautiful light. And that's, as photographers, that's what we're trying to do, is to create and manipulate shots. We haven't even talked about post-production yet. Well, I'm sure we're going to get into a little bit of that. I personally use Lightroom. I've been using Lightroom for some years, since Blake Jorgensen, a professional photographer up in Whistler. I did one of his classes a few years back with Jordan Manley and Eric Berger and Paul Morrison and Blake Jorgensen, which are all top four photographers in Whistler for backcountry photography, which is something that is a hobby of mine. I have done it for a while now. But I took this class and he turned me on to Lightroom, and I've never looked back. I just can't say enough about Lightroom. It's a great way to post-produce your shots. It's not a Photoshop, but it is an Adobe, and it does work in conjunction with Bridge and Photoshop if you want to get into that. But it's really an intuitive, easily learned tool, in my opinion, and it's the one that I use. You guys both are all use that as well?
I'm in it right now.
Excellent.
I actually use Bridge. Don't use Lightroom at all.
You should check out Lightroom, because really Bridge was what Lightroom was based on, because all the photographers that used Bridge, they wanted it to be something else, and then they created Lightroom.
Yeah, I've used Lightroom, and it's extremely powerful. But for the focus stacking and stuff, I feel like Bridge is a little bit easier, just because I'm sometimes working with 100 plus photos at a time. But yeah, Lightroom is very, very powerful.
Yeah, what stacking program are you using? Like a Halcyon or a Combines?
We use Zerine.
Zerine?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, nice. Yeah, I've only played around with stacking on a few occasions myself. I've only really maybe taken 3 or 4 stack shots. My friend used to write for, what is it, the guide, 91 Sticky Guide or something? Yeah, he turned me on to the stacking using Halcyon or whatever the name of the program was. It was cool. I liked it. I set it up, and he was like, you don't have a rail system? I'm like, no, I'll just move the subject. And I just took shots and did this with my finger.
It worked.
He couldn't believe it, actually. He was like, dude, I cannot believe you got that shot by moving the fucking thing with your finger.
I just wanted to say, your tip about flattening the subject, that is an awesome, awesome tip. Another thing with the MPE is that when you get more zoomed in, I'm sure you know this, but your depth of field drops completely. At 5 to 1, you're like getting half of a trichome head in focus. So then it's even more important to make sure you've got a flat focal plane.
It's true. You know, and it's funny because at first I learned that very early on. I was like, I've got to flatten these things. And then I was kind of like, okay, this whole flattening thing is great. I took some amazing shots, but it's limiting my photography. So then instead of flattening, I started to project the flattening as my depth of field. And I started, and this is when I really moved away from tripod shooting almost completely, because I needed to move my camera in, and it was Blake Jorgensen. No, sorry, it was Jordan Manley who gave me this tip at this photography course that I took in Whistler. I said, give me a tip, Jordan. And he said, well, put your camera where nobody puts their camera. That's how you get shots that nobody gets. And I was like, whoa, that's crazy. This is a guy who took a macro photograph. Okay, he's a mountain bike photographer. I urge you to go Google all of these guys, by the way, Jordan Manley. He works for like Arc'teryx now, and he does these crazy world video trips with his brother. But he set up a photograph. This is insane. He set up his camera on a leaf of a plant, and it was so dry, he even had to bring his own water, and he dropped a couple of drops of water on the leaf. And what he wanted to do was he set up his bike on the spot, this X that he had created, and he got his bike into focus in the refraction of the drop. Okay, you think that's good? Then a fucking fly came along and was feeding on the water, and he got the shot, him on the mountain bike, driving by the droplet, clicking the camera while he's on the bike, and the fucking fly is like sucking the water. I swear to God, when I saw that shot, I was like, I give up, I quit, I'm never, like, who are you? Like, you're an alien, you're just from another planet? And he is, truly, he's an inspirational photographer that will inspire you no matter what genre you're into. So check out that photo if you can. You can Google it. I'm sure it'll be like Jordan Manley fly micro mountain bike shot, but I've been shooting for 8 years and I've never considered getting a shot like that because I never considered putting my camera somewhere it had never been, away from me while I was on a bike driving. So gives you an idea.
I just wanted to speak on flattening really fast.
Please.
Kind of up there. Tony's not here, but he's the one who got me into the macro photography scene, and I left a link in the group chat on the right. He actually had an E-mount 5X, some Japanese company I've never heard of, Yashura, and he had a 5X macro lens, and we would throw that on his cinema camera body that he has. And what it had on the bottom, it has built-in LEDs, and it has a slot for slides. So we would take two microscope slides and literally just heat them up, or not even heat them, but just kind of pour out the granular hash and just flatten it out on that and slide those in. And that's how I have gotten a lot of my shots of just the grains really flat against the focal plane.
That's awesome.
It's a pretty cool lens. I decided to go with the MP65. I got this one for $750. That one was $5. I don't recommend that one, E-mount. It felt like a toy, and it just wasn't – the resolution wasn't there, but it was a good start, and it was a cool lens to work with.
Speaking of good lenses to start with, if people want to get into, you know, trying macro photography but don't want to drop $1,000 on the MPE, this one is great. It's the 35-80. I picked this up on eBay for like $30, and when you take off, there's three screws. If you take them off, then you remove this front element, you get a very cheap but very powerful macro lens. It does have some, you know, it's not going to create as sharp of images as you can get with the MPE, but it's a cheap way to kind of get into it and decide if macro photography is something you want to explore more in depth.
Damn, excellent. Excellent tip on that one, Eric. That's great. Great information. That's kind of what we're trying to gather here, you know, just create a dialogue, and in that natural dialogue have really useful little tips for the people that are watching. We have 140 people that are still watching, and I wouldn't be surprised if this video gets 5,000 to 10,000 views in the next week or so. So, you know, if you can think of the good things, definitely share them. Any little macro tricks that I know over the years, I'm always down for sharing. The flying of the subject is a big one. That can teach you how to move into creating that flattened subject in your own mind, because it's like a sphere. It's you're looking at this line of focus, and if you can move it around, it's just like when what's-his-face Luke Skywalker flew into the Death Star there. It was like he had to go right above and then down into the depth of field, that little line that he was in. And when he went in there, all of a sudden it was like, wow, everything's so clear, you can see everything. It was, that's just the same thing with photography. If you can manipulate that, your depth of field with your camera and find it in certain areas. I used to just shoot photographs like a portrait photographer. I would just shoot, and I wasn't really looking at the subject the way I needed to be. And then I started angling different angles, and that was when people really were like, wow, I don't know what you did, but your photography just took on a next level. And that was getting off of being tethered to anything. Being able to shoot handheld with your macro rig, in my opinion, is extremely important. And if you are learning macro photography, starting with bugs is not a bad idea, as they do move, and learning how to track and learning how to get those shots without being completely tethered. I mean, it's great once you've kind of learned a little bit to create the whole beautiful production. I love the prosthetics of photography, the extra lighting. Sometimes I shoot in the photo boxes, light boxes. You know, I've never shot with the remote, but that's a great idea for certain cases. Jordan Manley's photo in point in case, you pretty much would never be able to get that shot. He would never be able to get that shot without that little tool right there. And I think that it's all great. It's nice to see the whole variety of you guys are doing different things with different lenses and different camera bodies, and still getting really, really nice shots, as I can attest from all of your Instagram accounts. You guys have great photos of macro shots.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Eric, this on Canon EF 3580mm f/4.0563.
Yes, it's the Canon 35-80. If you search that, it should come up. It's a kit lens, so it came with tons of you know, Rebels and Canon cameras that people purchased, and you know, maybe they don't need them, so people get rid of them all the time on eBay. That's where I picked up mine. And then if you Google, you know, Canon 35-80 macro mod or just macro, you'll get tons of tutorials on how to take it apart. It's really easy. It's just three screws. You have to take a little sticker off first, and then just this front element comes off, and you get a lot more. I don't know what the like 1:1. I think it's past 1:1, but I don't know. But it's a great way to explore macro photography.
Yeah, you know, people will ask me all the time, like, how to get into it, and I'll just tell them, if they can find a cheap 1:1 lens that works for their camera, that just start there, you know, to make sure it's got the true macro.
Even extension tubes, too. Like, if you just have, you know, an SLR sitting around and you have a kit lens, you can go pick up some extension tubes, and all they do is they move the lens further away from the sensor, which allows you to focus closer, and it'll basically turn any lens that you have into a macro lens. It does start to you know, mess with the focus. Like when you turn the zoom, it goes out of focus and it doesn't actually, you know, zoom like it's supposed to. But play around with it and you'll get the hang of it.
Yeah, that's all that MPE is. It's just a big extension tube lens. That's what I think. It's like, just get a bunch of extension tubes. If you really, or you can reverse mount, you know? It's just an extension tube lens. That's all it is.
I think you're right.
I think the issue a lot of people run into with just going pure extension tubes is that they don't have nearly enough light, and then a lot of the times the extension tubes won't communicate with the camera properly. So I know that was an issue I had early on where I was just like, okay, so if I put three on, then it no longer works. If I have two on, then it works fine. And if you're buying an extension tube, it's best to probably spend the money and get a good one, because I've definitely had a lot of shitty ones that either break or just flat out don't communicate with the sensor. So you'll end up, you know, but if you're going that route, you may as well just, you know, spend the, like if you have a lens like this, this is about a $400 or $500 lens, nothing major. If you're going to spend all that money on extension tubes, you may as well just get the damn 5-to-1, you know, so it's kind of, But yeah.
I mean, with extension tubes, I was going to mention with macro in general, flash is your friend. Shooting, like, even especially with extension tubes, you lose a couple f-stops, and you're going to need to change your exposure to compensate. But doing long exposures in macro, there's so much movement that can happen. If you're at 5-to-1 or even 1-to-1, even somebody walking across, you know, on the other side of the room can cause movement, and that if you're doing a, you know, quarter of a second exposure, you're going to get a blurry picture.
Dab break.
Just needed to take a dab break, yeah. I was going to get it all set up and macro it to show the dab, and then my $300 sapphire bowl, like, unscrewed while it was 580 degrees. It was sitting on top. I just screwed it back on with my skillet tool. Shout out to skillet tool. I guess I better focus on photography and not bong rips, huh? Probably a good idea. Anyway, yeah, still 140 people hanging out and watching. The chat room's going off. People are interested in hearing a little bit about what we're doing. It's nice to see. Lens reversal kits, you know, I always kind of wanted to get into it, and I missed that whole boat by getting the Canon MPE, and it may very well just be some billows, but it seems to be more than that when you just consider the quality of the images that come out of this lens. From an amateur standpoint of literally, personally, I photographed with this lens for 8 months before National Geographic called me up and hired me to take photos of macro pot plants. And that was 8 months. I'm like Rye. I was like, I do not call myself a professional photographer. In fact, it's just a hobby, really. Definitely not my job. I kind of learned. I thought people needed education, and I needed education. You know, like Kale was saying about the sap. Photograph that sap. And in photographing that sap, I learned about that sap. And the same thing to do with trichomes and all the other different microscopic things found from stigma hair, capitate, distillate hair, all of it. You learn about it.
I know I've talked a little bit with Kale about it, but the double-headed trichomes, have you seen any of those? I know Kale's been posting some lately. I don't know, do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, I consider it's tough because I've seen so much happen under the macro lens. I've definitely seen double-headed trichomes, both with dual top stops and obviously with the much more often seen, which I always think of it for sure as heads that have been removed from other heads, have fallen into the plant and then landed like a little hat right on top. Quite different from the separate stalks coming out of a single stalk.
I always like the idea of trying to photograph dual-headed trichomes 360 degrees around, so you can see that maybe it, is it like a tree that when they grow too close together, they grow into one another, or is it actually a trichome that has produced two heads? They're definitely cool.
Yeah, they're super cool.
Most of the ones I've seen seem to have a larger stalk, like a wider stalk, like kind of goes together.
Yep. Totally. Yeah. I often wonder if it's just some form of mutation. It would be something that a breeder might want to be looking at if that was an actual mutation. Someone like Kevin McKernan, who we've had on Hash Church, talking about, of course, the sequencing of the genome of cannabis and finding that switch. Imagine being able to breed with those sort of helps, where you could start with a plant that produces all of its heads produced two triplet trichomes. Interesting concept.
Yeah. So if you check, I actually have a three-headed that you can tell there's three separate stalks, and I took a photo from above to kind of make sure you could tell they're all alive. Three stalks, one stalk, or three glands, one stalk, and I don't know. It's just rare. It just happens every once in a while. You catch them.
Yeah.
I don't know why. But here, someone's actually asking you, Spokane Cannabis Review. Do you use studio strobes, nug shots?
I use a single Canon speed light.
I have I use four lights. I have a white plexiglass board that I set up. I work this as my background. That's set right here right now. I get this bent up and this gives me a perfectly white background. And I'll just do four flash heads. Two on the subject, two right behind it at a 45-degree angle, cancel out any shadows. Usually get a perfect shot every time, really simple.
Gets the job done. I tell you, in this almost 10 years I've been shooting with this light, the only light that I've used with this lens is this flash. And this flash, for those of you that are wondering, because it's always helpful, we've told you the name of the lens, the MPE. The flash that I use is the MT24EX dual flash from Canon. It's a $650 lens. MPE is probably going to run you about $800, and then you got to get a tripod and a head for starters anyway, and a camera body, and you're off to the races.
And if you're trying to go like I was, I honestly recommend this Yongo digital brand of flash. I've went through a lot of generic flashes, and these ones seem to be built up to the same specs as the Canon ones ship with. So,
Do they have a dual over a ring?
No, that's the only downside. So with the ring, I just cancel one ring and then hold another flashlight off to the side, or flash head. But no, you don't get that ability to flex and adjust like you do with the.
I didn't like the way the ring flash looked on 5.1 in trichome heads. The way it refracted the light, I just found it was like I needed to get rid of 80% of that light. Even still, the small little half moon flashes that I use bug the shit out of me when I see their reflections in the heads.
Yeah. Definitely.
It's too much all over light, that I would tell people. It's just too much all over. It needs to be more of a point for you to get that definition.
Absolutely.
Here, I just want to let people know, I also use the same flash as you, that MT24EX. It's pretty expensive, but I will use a studio flash as well, just off to the side sometimes.
Yeah, because, hey, why not?
Yeah, exactly. It's hard to get that light in there.
It is very hard to get that light in there. Most of the time I'm shooting with this lens, I'll have it in an auto white balance. Due to how close I'm going, I find that it works just fine. I shoot in RAW, so even if my white balance is off in any way, it's completely correctable in Lightroom. More often than not for macro photography, I prefer low f-stops. I really like the sharpness that they have to offer, although
it's nice to see a full image and get as much clarity as possible. I still find that anything really over 9 or 8 even is, it just softens the image for me in a way that, to be honest, it's one of the reasons I stayed away from quite a few years, well, for all the years almost now, from combining shots and stacking shots. I found when I did it, the few times I did it, there was a halo effect. This could have also been the fact that it was 8 years ago. And I found that the halo effect that I was getting around the trichomes just didn't look the same way as when I took like a really clear single shot. Christopher Rex and a few others have obviously shown me that nowadays you can get impeccable combination shots, stacks of multi-dozens or 15 or more shots stacked into a single image. Eric was saying sometimes he uses up to 100 images. That's incredible.
Lightroom is... I was just going to say Lightroom's program for that workflow, because you could bring in your stacks, edit the first one the way you like, have Lightroom copy those edits out to all 50 photos, and then with one click you could send those to Photoshop, and Photoshop will open them in layers and orders, and then you click it one more time and it'll stack them, and it does really, really, really well.
Yeah, that's nice for sure. Lightroom is so helpful in that way. I've never personally done that, but I couldn't imagine doing it any other way once you learned that all you have to do is edit a single shot and pass that information on to all the shots. That's pretty key. I'm sure Bridge must do that for you, though.
Well, we actually do it after the fact. So I don't post-process before stacking. Stacking is first. But one thing that I've noticed is there's really not one way to do this. We all have drastically different techniques and processes with different gear, and you still end up with some really great shots afterwards. But one thing I wanted to mention on the MPE and the f-stops, there's, if you look online, I don't remember where, but they have comparisons at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5x, and it seems like around f8 is better at 1:1, and the further in you get, it's actually sharper if you drop that f-stop down. So around f2.8, I don't know exactly what it is, but those comparisons are really, really helpful.
Nice. And where can they could just Google those?
Yeah, I'll try and find a link to those. I've seen a couple of them around.
Yeah, absolutely, because that sounds like a helpful link. I'm not exactly sure where we're going to post this stuff. Probably a lot of the people watching are from Hash Church. Maybe I could get away with a bit, but I might have to create a group. I might end up doing another one of these as well. You never know. If people are receptive and we can get a nice group in each time, we can do another one and share some tips and tricks. We've been rocking it for an hour and a half already. That's pretty decent for a first camera episode. I'm wondering if there's anything we didn't really touch on in regards to macro photography.
You talked about post-processing. We talked a little bit about stacking specifically, but maybe there's other stuff people are curious about.
Yeah, anybody shoot an iPhone or an adapter to their phone? I've seen a few people do it.
I've never seen anything really come out of a phone that's impressed me.
It'll look great on Instagram, but you're not going to be able to print it.
I have a 31-inch 4K screen I use, so it's like my photos look amazing, but everything else looks horrible. It's just like, even the quality of this camera, like my camera, it looks so shitty on my monitor right now. It's kind of ridiculous.
For any Nikon people, the similar unit that I use is the wireless remote Speedlight SBR200. So like I said, you can kind of use, I think, up to 8 of these off of one body, and they can be controlled remotely. There's no wires or anything. So these are super convenient. The actual lights themselves, I think, are about $250 a piece. They're actually controlled by the main controller of the camera, so you don't need like an actual unit. So the way that Nikon has it, everything is controlled via RF, or the way that I do it, it actually pulls it from this flash. So I have this blacked out, and then it notices that it's flashing, and then it flashes. So it's like a slave unit sort of.
Hey, and do you Oh, what was the question I was going to ask? It was, man, I lost that in a brief second. I might need another bong rip. I had a good question for you, too. Damn. John, keep moving. Anytime soon.
I'm going to post
Have any of you guys...
Sorry, I was just saying, I found the site I was looking for about those f-stop comparisons to sharpness, so I'm just going to post that in the chat.
Yeah, post that in the chat. For now, these links I'll just put in Hashchurch until I can build a group, and that way, you know, the people watching can have a place to go to. Obviously, they don't have... got a good little chunk of people in the chat room. It seems like it's, you know, it makes about good sense. We usually get about 1,000 people watching Hashchurch. We got about 10% of that. Seems probably a pretty high number for the percentage of people that actually photograph cannabis on a level that is borderline professional, if Rye doesn't want to use the word professional. I always felt the same way. It just felt like a weird ego thing where you're like, I'm a professional photographer. I like to call myself a practicing photographer. And I've been practicing for 20 years myself, maybe a little bit longer, and it's always a learning experience. I definitely don't feel like I've come anywhere near learning everything I need to learn about photography. So it's kind of a neat way to get into something where you always stay open, you're always a student, and I think that it allows for your art form to, you know, get to those next levels by acknowledging that the people who are your peers have great information to share with you. And it's why I wanted to invite you guys in and to get some of this information out. Your photographs obviously have inspired me enough to enjoy them and want to get you guys in here to share. So I want to thank Dane and Eric and Rye and Kale for coming in today. You can check them all out on their Instagram accounts, which we will also post in Hashchurch in the one post that I'm going to put all of these links in. We'll have all of our contacts if you want to stay in touch or if you want to check out the art. I think that's it, guys. Thanks so much for coming in. Really appreciate it.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you both.
Absolutely. Until next time, and you guys will be invited next time, grab your cameras. Get yourself a macro lens and start playing around. You'll be very inspired to where it can lead to. It's more than just taking pictures, I promise. Thanks for watching, everyone. Peace.